Hello my dear friends, I'm Dhanya Divagar. Once again, a warm welcome to my channel Shades of Literature. Thanks to all for subscribing my channel and also for leaving your valuable comments. So, in my last lecture, I gave you a detailed analysis of Franz Fanon's Black Skin, White Mass. Today, I'll be dealing with yet another work of Franz Fanon, that is The Wretched of the Earth, which was published in the year 1961. As I've given you an introduction to Fanon, I'll not be doing the same thing in this lecture. I'll straight away enter into the work. So, as an introductory note, Fanon says few things in his book. So, I'll just give you an introduction to the book. The book can be classified or clubbed under the category of modern classic. Fanon, in this book, tries to speak about certain things such as decolonization. It's a seminal work. The book is a seminal work which tries or which helps us to understand more about certain terms or certain aspects such as decolonization, political violence, power structures, etc. And the book is written from the perspective of a colonized man. And what does Fanon explain in his book? What is the whole book about? The whole book is about how and why colonialism should be stopped. Okay, so this is the these are the things which Fanon focuses in his book, The Wretched of the Earth. He also speaks about colonialism. How did this happen? Is it like a pre-planned agenda or is it accidental? He very clearly states that colonialism is not at all accidental. It's a pre-planned agenda or a well-planned agenda by the colonial powers. He very clearly states this. So these are the few things which Fanon says as an introductory note to his work, The Wretched of the Earth. The book is divided into 5 chapters. The first chapter would be titled as On Violence. The first chapter has 2 divisions. The second division is titled as Violence in International Context. So in the first section, Fanon speaks about decolonization, the power structures, the political divisions in the society. He also speaks about the effects of decolonization, what happens after decolonization to the masses. These things are being explained in the first section of the first chapter. In the second section, Fanon discusses about the effects of colonization in the international milieu. So coming back to the first section of the first chapter on violence, Fanon begins the first chapter by explaining the term decolonization. Now you will be thinking, okay, I've heard about colonization, colonizer, the colonized mass, lots of terms you would have heard from here and there. It's all confusing things. It's enough of enough. You would be thinking like that. Okay, just forget about all that. Decolonization is very simple. Fanon explains it by saying that it's the liberation of a nation and the restoration of the same nation to its people. This is the simple definition which you can give to the term decolonization. So now the next question would be, already you know what is decolonization. Now the next question would be, how can you attain or how can you do this decolonizing? How can you do this? Is it by a war or is it by shaking hands with somebody else or is it by saying hi, hello to somebody? No, Fanon has clearly said that you just cannot attain decolonization by gentleman's agreement or by shaking hands. Just keep in mind, whenever you write an essay or a short note on Franz Fanon's Wretched of the Earth, you have to remember certain terminologies used by the author. So just keep in mind these terms like gentleman's agreement, shake hands. These are the terms used by Fanon in his book. So he clearly states that you just cannot decolonize a nation by doing shake hands or by gentleman's agreement. Instead of that, what can you do? You just have to use violence. So this is what Fanon says. You just cannot go in a way where you are considering the other group as your friend. Okay, come, we'll have a nice time. No, you just can't do that. You cannot decolonize a nation when you keep such an attitude in your mind. So Fanon clearly says that. Now, Once you have the solution, okay, you can only decolonize through violent means. Now the next question would be, what would be the mentality of the colonizer and the colonized to this decolonization? Just imagine what would be the mentality. Will they have a happy kind of feeling, or will they have a sad feeling? Just imagine, it's very simple. The colonizer would be having that fear in his mind. Oh my God, these people are going to decolonize. What if my plans won't work hereafter? That kind of feeling will be always there inside a colonizer. Fanon clearly states that the colonizer will have this fear of decolonization. Now coming back to the colonized mass, what will they feel? Will they be happy? Yeah, obviously they'll be very much happy because they're going to get back their nation. So the colonized mass will always have that desire towards decolonization. Okay, so this is what Fanon explains about the mentality or the attitude of these two sections of people towards decolonization. Now he also says that when you decolonize, we create new men and we dismantle the colonial situation. It's obviously true. When you decolonize a nation, again new men are created or new ideologies are created, whereas the colonial situation would be dismantled. Now he focuses on the divisions which happened in the society. So divisions in the sense we already know, there are two sections of people. One, the first division or the first division or the first world, it's known as the first division or the first world, they are the colonizer, and the second division is the colonized group. Okay, so these two groups are there, and both the world of a colonizer and that of a colonized is totally different. The world of a colonizer is somewhere here and that of the colonized is somewhere down here. So Fanon clearly states that. So now what separates the colonizer from the colonized? Fanon says that soldier barracks and police force separates colonizer from the colonized. How do they separate? They use power, they use ammunition, they use weapons to separate the colonizer world from that of the world of the colonized. So Fanon clearly states this, the world of the colonizer and the world of the colonized is separated using power, violence, ammunition and weapons. Now coming to the feelings of these two people, the colonizer and the colonized, are they feeling equal? Do they have an equal status in the society? No, they don't have an equal status. The colonizer is always having a supreme kind of level, and the colonized is somewhere else down there. He is not at all supreme. He doesn't have wealth. He is in utter poverty. He is having hunger. His children are dying. So he is somewhere down there in the trenches. Now the colonizer, he is wealthy. He has everything at his hands. So coming to the equality, these both sections or these two groups of people, they can nowhere be compared at the same level. Fanon also says this. Fanon clearly states that these two worlds are inhabited by different species of people. The ruling sections of the society is inhabited by the colonizer, and the other section, the colonized mass, is inhabited by the indigenous population. So now you have two sections. We have two sections of people, the colonizer and the colonized. And this division in the society, Fanon uses a particular term for this. It's a Manichaean world. Manichaean world in the sense that the world of the colonizer, the ruling species, and that of the indigenous population. So it's like a Manichaean world. He uses it as an analogy. So what is this Manichaean? Manichaean, it's a religion in Persia during 3rd century. This religion was there in Persia, and this religion has contradictory opposing views, such as this religion believes in good as well as in evil forces. So it has contradictory perspective towards the values and morals. So this religion was found in Persia in the 3rd century, and Fanon uses this as an analogy to explain colonialism. So you have to keep in mind it's a Manichaean world where both good and evil are present. He uses the term species also, which describes more about animal instincts. Species, we usually use the term species with animals. So this also you need to keep in mind. So these are the few things which Fanon speaks about the division of the society in the colony, whichever colony was colonized by the colonizer. Now, after the power structure, he explains the power structure. And now what happens after colonization? This is the next, towards the end of the first section of the first chapter. He describes what happens after decolonization. Okay, once the nation is decolonized, what is the next step? Will the colonizer and the colonized, will they put their hands on their shoulders and will they be very happy to live together? No, you just imagine, will they be happy? No, they will not be. The colonizer will always have that superiority feeling. Okay, I'm the best. I'm the supreme power. He'll have that even though he is thrown out from the colonized land. Still, he'll have that feeling. Whereas the colonized mass, they'll be happy to coexist with the colonizer. They'll be very much happy. Okay, come, we'll live together. That kind of feeling will be there for the colonized mass. But the colonizer will not be happy. They always want that supreme power or that superiority status. They always want that. Once they don't get it, they just leave. This is what happened to each and every colony. And once they left, we had to bear with all those negativities which they had implanted in each and every colony. We had to suffer after they left a lot. In the sense, it's not like this much or that much. We had to suffer a lot and we are still suffering. So now, after decolonization, what happened? Was it the colonizer or the colonized thereafter? No. Now it totally changed. Now it's the colonized intellectuals. Who are these colonized intellectuals? Again, the society was divided. You must understand, if initially it was the colonizer and the colonized, now after decolonization, it has changed into colonized intellectuals. Colonized intellectuals are the learned people who gets into the administrative works, clerks. They're the experts. Okay, so they are the intellectuals. They are the learned people. Now there is yet another class called the colonialist bourgeoisie, who always have liking towards the Western ideologies and Western concepts. These people would have served the colonial powers when they were here or when they were ruling the colonized land. So these were colonialist bourgeoisie is also there. Now what will happen with these two groups? The colonized intellectual, they are the learned people. They just don't have much interest in any other things. They just are very happy, very contentful with whatever position they have in the society. Now colonialist bourgeoisie, they take this opportunity to fuel up the colonized intellectuals. What do? They just convince them saying that the Western ideologies are superb. You have to follow the Western ideology. Western concepts are really good. Please do follow this. This is what the colonialist bourgeoisie does to the colonized intellectual. And once these both two groups comes together, the concept of colonialism, Fanon says that it's a big question mark. Are we really decolonized or are we really free from the shackles of the colonial power? No, the answer is a very big no. We are still being again colonized in one aspect or the other. This is what Fanon says. So in order to stop this bourgeoisie thing or this colonial bourgeoisie, the bonding of colonial bourgeoisie and colonized intellectuals should be stopped forever. Only then the real essence of decolonization would reach into the real mass of the nation. This is what Fanon says. Now, he says that conducting great rallies and demonstrations on the roads, in the public sectors, all these you can only do it on a very sober manner. You just can't do it by using violent means. He says that whenever such rallies and demonstrations are there, it doesn't reach it to the to the real masses over there. Why? Because they are done in a very sober kind of manner. In order to trigger the element of the element of decolonization or the element of nationhood, the feeling that, okay, I want freedom from the colonial power, that kind of feeling, in order to trigger that feeling, what should we do? Fanon says that we should use violence. At this note, he just ends the first section of his chapter. He clearly states that without violence, decolonization cannot be possible. Now, coming to the second section of the first chapter, it's titled as Violence in International Context. Fanon speaks about how the power was distributed, or how the wealth was distributed to the Europe and to the rest of the third world countries. Europe says that they are rich, they have wealth, and everything they had, that notion itself is ridiculous. This is what Fanon says. Europe didn't have anything. Whatever they had, they just stole and they just exploited the third world countries, and that's how they became wealthy. Fanon says this very clearly. He says that the Europeans, they didn't have anything at their hands. They are now in this situation just because they stole and exploited the third world countries. He also says that the distribution of wealth was not fairly done. If Europe, after the Second World War and after the Nazist attack and the colonization which happened in Europe during the Nazist attack, after all these things, the other countries, the other third world nations tried to help Europe, but they didn't give it back in the same way to the third world countries. They always looted and plundered the third world countries. Fanon clearly states that Europe is now wealthy just because of the third world countries. If the conflict earlier was between colonialism and anti-colonialism, now it is between capitalism and socialism. This is what Fanon says. And the capitalist exploitation is the biggest enemy of a nation towards attaining its freedom, or towards attaining a supreme position amongst all other nations. So this capitalist exploitation, once when it is stopped, everything would be fine and fair. This is what Fanon says in his second section of the first chapter. Now, coming to the second chapter, Grandeur and Weakness of Spondenti. This is the title of the second chapter. Here, Fanon speaks about two sections of people. In the first chapter itself, I introduced the colonized intellectual. Here, Fanon speaks about the colonized intellectual and the common mass, the common people of the country. So he just gives an elaborated explanation about these two sections of people. Now, the colonized intellectuals are also known as urban proletariat. They are the learned people, they are the intellectuals, they hold up the supreme positions in the society, such as drivers, nurses, doctors, administrators, clerks, etc. Whereas the other group, the common mass, the peasant mass, they are the they live in the rural sectors of the country, and they are called or termed as lumpen proletariats. They live in the rural areas. They just hate city life. They just want to live in rural setup itself. They just don't want to get exposed to the urban life. So now, what does these two people do? The colonialists are the colonial powers. They very well know the agenda of the urban proletariat as well as that of the lumpen proletariat, and they take up this situation or this situation as an advantage, and they fuel up flames of discontent amongst these two sections. You should keep in mind, even after decolonization, when this process of decolonization started, these colonial powers, they didn't leave the country, or they didn't leave their colonies all of a sudden. They were still staying back. It's only after when the decolonization came to a supreme end, only after that did we get freedom. So now, the urban proletariat is there. Urban proletariat in the sense, the bourgeoisie group or the intellectual group, the colonized intellectuals, all these are the same. They are more concerned about the political structure. Okay, keep in mind that the urban proletariat or the bourgeoisie or the learned people, the colonized intellectuals, they are more concerned with the political structure, the politics of the nation, etc. They are not interested in the emancipation of the nation or welfare of the nation. No, they are more concerned about the politics. But the urban, the rural mass, that is the peasant mass, their supreme aim is nation, the welfare of the nation. They just want freedom. That's their aim. So now the colonial powers, they know what these two people have, they have in their mind. And this situation, they take advantage of the situation. They fuel up the flames of discontent in both these people, and there starts a conflict. They just created conflicts among these two people. So now what happened was rebellions, outbreaks, etc. happened. So now who were there standing at the forefront of these rebellions? Even though the colonized intellectuals or the bourgeoisies wanted freedom, they never came into the forefront. They had in their mind, okay, I too need freedom, but I'll not do anything to attain that. They wanted freedom, but they will not work for it. They always kept the peasant masses or the lumpen proletariat. Just keep this term in your mind. It's lumpen proletariat. They always used these lumpen proletariats to get freedom or for any rebellious things for that matter. So these people, they just came into the forefront. They were least bothered about their family, least bothered about anything happened to them. They were not at all bothered about anything. They just had one supreme thought in their mind, that is the welfare of the country. And these people, who hated city life, they just came into the urban milieu. They started exposing themselves towards the urban life. They conquered. So Fanon is explaining all these things in his second chapter. So these lumpen proletariats, they work for the national cause. They are least bothered about any harm happening to them. They are just bothered about the nation and the welfare of their country. And they act spontaneously. It's not like somebody should light them up or trigger them or just give a dose or a boost up dose. Nothing. Nothing of that sort is needed for them. They just act spontaneously. They believe in rebellions and violence. And this is how they attained freedom. This is what Fanon says in his second chapter, Grandeur and Weakness of Spontaneity. So, The Wretched of the Earth has five sections, five chapters. In the next video, I'll be explaining the next three chapters. It's a quite big book. So all the five chapters cannot be covered in one video. It will be too much. So in this video, I've just concentrated on the first two chapters of Fanon's book, The Wretched of the Earth. The next three chapters will be covered in the next video. Until then, stay safe at your house. Please do take care. Just don't forget to subscribe my channel. Also leave your valuable comments in my inbox. Don't forget to ping on the bell button so that you get notified whenever I upload a new video. Thank you. Bye-bye.